Hello everyone, Mark here. Welcome back to my garage. So, this is part two of the main spindle build for the PM Research milling machine kit. This time I've got all the holes to drill down the centre of it, which is a initial hole that's a number 24 hole that needs to be drilled 1¼ inches deep from the front. And then after that there is a number 51 drill hole that goes then through the rest of the part. And then after that, at the very front, to act as a register, there is a number 1 tapered hole, using a number 1 tapered reamer, that goes 1/2 inch deep. So this will be interesting to see how it turns out. So let's bring you over to the lathe and let's start setting up to centre drill and then start drilling. Okay, so I've got the bit already still set up. I'm going to go in with a number 1 centre drill because it is a very small hole. So let's start off by putting a number 1 centre drill in the chuck. These are high quality centre drills that I use. There we go. Let's remove that off there, I don't need that on there. So let's lock that in. And let's just make sure that... yep, that's going to work just fine. Lock off my tailstock and let's start the lathe up. A second for that to kick in. There we go, that's that started. Make sure that's in zero, everything's disengaged, good. Starter spinning. Yeah, let's make sure that's spinning. There she goes, spinning nicely. Right. Let me grab a dobble of cutting oil. Let's start her going. There we go, and that is the centre. Very nice, very nice. Let's knock that off, beam and nib off. Let's take the centre out. Put that safely back in its box because I don't want to risk losing that or risk it getting damaged, because like I said, I'd paid quite a bit of money for my centres because I like my centres. Then I'm going to come in with the number 24 bit. Now I've put some tape on the bit to show how far deep I need to go with it, because I have no scale apart from the main scale on the quill of the tailstock, and to be brutally honest, it's not that easy to read. There's no dial on the handle or anything like that to change, and I don't have any form of DRO on it or dial indicator for it either. So I'm just going to take this nice and slow, nice gentle cuts, bit of cutting oil on it, and let's do this as a bit of time lapse. So in theory, that should be drilled to depth now, The only thing I've got that will fit in that hole and I can then just mark a line on is an Allen key. So let's just see. That is the perfect depth. So that is perfect. That's fantastic. Now the next phase is the real tricky one. I've got to drill the number 51 drill bit right the way through the rest of it. Now the bit itself will not fit and actually reach all the way through from this end, so I'm going to have to take it out, chuck it up the other way, and then drill it from the other end and hope that it stays concentric. Just take nice gentle slow cuts. So let me get that set up. I'll take this out, pop it any way around, and get sorted ready. Well, here's something you don't see every day, and that is a steady rest being used on a Myford ML7. I mean, a Super 7, because quite a lot of times this is the piece of equipment that just stays rusting in the bottom of the tray, of the chip tray, or under the bench, and just sits here doing nothing. But because this part is so long, so thin, and with so little grip at this end, I decided it would be a good idea to true it up and then put a steady rest on it to support the end of it, because as you can see, there's quite a lot of stick out spinning there, so having a nice steady rest to support that is rather useful, shall we say. So, it bit me, but anyway, needs must, I've got this set up. Now this drill needs to go all the way through until it breaks through into the other bore that I just drilled. So, I have it in, I'm going to take very, very steady cuts with it. Plenty of cutting fluid on, and let's go. Well, the drill bit did absolutely splendidly. It did that without a flaw. Just kept pecking at it until I started to feel the chips build up, back it out again so I don't risk snapping the bit. And then just kept going until I broke through. The steady rest was definitely a good idea to support it at this point. I'm glad I thought to do that. So yeah, I am super happy with how that went. So, the second to final part on this is to do the tapered bore on the other side, there's a taper, number one taper that goes in the end there, that I just need to double check the drawing as to how deep that needs to be. Then I need to set it up and come in with the number one tapered reamer. So, let's go over to the bench and I'll show you what I need to do. So this is where it gets interesting. I now have all the dimensions here correct. I have the bores running through it correctly as well. However, the one thing I now need to do is put this tapered reamer into that end of the part. Because as it says right here, in number one, taper pin ream to receive a number one taper pin, which is in the kit, it needs to be 1/2 inch deep. So currently, that starts off there quite nice. That's good. I need to make sure that this is in line, so I'll need to use a centre in the tailstock. Make sure this is clamped up nice and tight. And I somehow need to make sure that I measure exactly 1/2 inch depth on here. But the problem is I can't just do 1/2 inch on this, because it starts off partly down the bore. So I need to get it in there so I know where it needs to start. And then I need to measure 1/2 inch along here from this point. So
Let's get doing that.
Okay, I've got it set up. I'm gonna keep the spindle locked, and I'm going to wind it in by hand. Wind that back out of the way a bit. Move that around so I don't clout it. Yeah, I'm going to do this by hand up until the first mark that you can probably just see there. Then I'm going to take a measurement and see if that's correct. So let's do this. Helps if you lock the tailstock. I apologise with my hand getting in the way, but I want to keep this central. And just keep light pressure to keep it centralised while I put this tapered hole in. I want to make sure that I get this a nice fit. There we go. That's into the depth of the first one. So that is to there. Let's just blow that out. I know, it's weird, isn't it? Seeing air on my videos. That looks rather nice. Now I'm going to go dig out the tapered pin out of the kit and see how well it fits. So, here's the pin. That goes in there quite nicely, and that nearly locked. So it's definitely a nice taper there. So let me seat that in there, like so. And then I'll take a measurement from that end down to there. I'll use the guesstimators, because this isn't a fancy measurement at the moment. So the guesstimators will do just fine. Is there. So according to the guesstimators, that is 407 thou. That's 407 thou sticking out of there. So what I now need to do is find the arbor on the drawing and measure how far in this pin seats for then on the actual arbor to make sure I've got the fit just right of this taper. So let me go find that on the drawing and I'll get a measurement. So it's not quite deep enough yet, nearly but not quite. So let's come in and take it to that second mark that I made. So let's come in, get that centre in there, start turning that in. Should be about there. just a little bit deeper. I'm looking for around 180 thou across the end there. And currently it is about 170. Let's go in a tiny bit more. Let's see how that is. Just blow that out as well. Let's see. It's just about the right depth to me. I'll try actually going in with the reamer and seeing how deep that is. Which is there. Now this, according to the thing, it was like half an inch, it said. Would be that. Let me just check something. It should be that. That's it. That's the depth. So if I now take the pin again, pop that in. Ah, yes, there we go. That goes in a nice way now. In fact, that goes in really well. That locked instantly. I didn't even have to put pressure on that. So that looks like it's the taper's properly formed now. That's in to its proper depth. And in theory now, that should be spinning nice and true. Nice and concentric. The proper way of testing that is to spin up the lathe and see how it's doing. So to do that, I'm going to drop it down to a slow speed. Oh, yeah, bastard. Like that. Crush your fingers in the pulleys, which is always fun. And then, yeah, that should be fine. Small to big, big to small, that's on medium speed. Let's set that go in. Remove the spindle lock. And let's see. Well, that pin's running nice and true. That's looking nice. I'm quite happy with that. I'm going to set up, just out of curiosity, it's not critical, at the end of the day, it's a model. But I'm going to set up a DTI on here and see if I can measure what this runout is. Hopefully you peeps can see that, but this is a tenths indicator. maybe... That's just the that's the amount of movement in the spindle of this lathe. So I can't detect any error in this at all, which I think's rather good. So I am happy with how that has turned out. That's wonderful. So there's only one step left to do, and that is to mill a flat in this for a keyway. For a grub screw rather, to lock into for when I finally get round to making the pulleys and the pulley for the main spindle. So set this up in the mill and cut that flat. Well, no matter how I tried, I could not get it to work in the little mini mill. Primarily because I don't have a long enough end mill and a collet chuck. So I'm decided to go to the vertical slide on the Super 7 instead. It's a system that I know works, so I may as well make use of it. So I've got it all set up, ready to rock, ready to roll. I've already got the depth and the height I need, in theory. Yep, that looks fine. Catch the camera, make you all seasick. Right, feeding back to front, as it should be. So I'm not climb milling, and everything looks good. Bits in the chuck, that's all tightened down, I made sure of that. That's great. Let's set her going. Start the lathe up, going forward. Wait for it all to spin up. There we go, and let's start the spindle. There it goes. Now I'm gonna bring this across like that, and then I'm just gonna there we go, that's a touch off. I'm going to feed it in slightly, and then I'm going to lock the carriage, which I haven't got my spanner. All else fails, use an adjustable. And then let's power feed it on out. Wind it back through. That seems fine. Let's undo the carriage. Knock it in a bit further. Tighten it down again. Engage the feed. Wind it back in. Seems good to me. Now I'm going to wind it in a bit further so I know I'm clear. I'm going to wind it up. I'm going to have to move the camera, guys. I cannot see what's going on. There we go. That seems about right, so let's power it back on out again. Wind it back across. Okay, it needs to come up slightly more. Let's try that. Wind that back in. A little bit more. A Now I need to come down. Feet out. Not quite. Back in. Down a bit more. Still not quite. There we go, that's the correct height now. Just gonna let it feed out a bit. There we go. Disconnect that, stop the spindle. We'll wind it back out so I can get to measure the width of this flat. So, let me grab my... There we go. So that is 110 thou. And according to the drawing, it needs to be exactly that. So, by happy little accident, as Bob Ross would say, a nice happy little accident, I now have the flat milled in. Looking at it, it hits the scribe lines exactly. It's nice and flat and flush. It's a good depth. It's the correct width, so it must be the right depth. If you go by the rules, because obviously if it's the right width as the drawing, that way on, it has to be then to the correct depth as well. So at the end of the day, it's not like it's a keyway. It's just a flat for a set screw for then the step pulley to register to not slip on the shaft. That's all it's for. So after that, took me an hour to set up for literally 1.5 minutes of milling. So, but on the other hand, I love this machine and I love working in the shop. So that, to me, makes all the difference. So, all I've done here to hold this is the Starrett Precision V-block again, with the clamp. And I'm using some gauge blocks here to support the base of the pin so the pin doesn't bend and provide good clamping action to the face of the vertical slide here. Again, there's a bit of shim stock just underneath the set screw so it doesn't mar the shaft, and then the toe clamps are actually the ones off the little mini mill, because it turns out they fit quite nicely to work for this size as well. So at least I can interchange clamping hardware between the two. And that was just a, let me see what size this was, I think it was a 6mm. Yes, this was a 6mm four flute top quality Chinesium end mill. So it cut rather nice, and it's a nice flat, so that's beautiful. And there we have it. One completed spindle. There you can see the flat turned out beautifully. Quite pleased with how that turned out, actually. The Chinesium cutter did really quite well on that, I'm quite surprised. And there it is, all the spindle. Down the end there is the taper. And you can just see, there's a through hole right down it. That was the fun part, drilling that hole. Goes all the way down through there. And as you can see by putting it on the drawing, it's all to the correct lengths and in the correct spaces, so that's always a bonus. when everything turns out correctly. So that is that part done. There's the taper pin that goes in the end there. That sits in there nicely. And that requires some force then to break the taper, so I know for a fact that the taper does seat correctly. And when I put it in, there's no slop or wiggle on it, so I know that it has... In fact, that's just locked in again. So yeah, I hardly put any pressure on that, and it's seated, so I know the taper is correct and working properly. So that is fantastic news. So there it is. That is the spindle shaft, item number 23 on the milling machine kit, complete. Essentially, if you think about it, that's possibly the most critical part of the whole thing, because it has to be exactly straight and concentric for the spinning, because it's the main axis that spins. So I'm glad I tackled this tricky part first, because all the other shafts then don't have to be as precise in terms of dimensions. I don't have to worry about them. Well, tell a lie. I want them to be precise, obviously. This is a machining channel, not a woodworking channel, so I need it to be accurate to below a 16th. So it's this, though, was something that I was always worrying about as to whether I would be able to pull this off, because this is by far the highest precision thing I've ever done in this machine shop, so I'm happy that I've been able to achieve it. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to watch this video. I'm glad it's done. Like I said, I wasn't expecting this to be a two-parter, but it turned into one. Thank you once again for sticking through it if you made it to this end of the video. Not sure what to do next. I might do some more of the other shafts. In fact, on the same page as the spindle, there is the knee feed shaft, just here. I think I might have a go at doing that next, because there's some fine threads that need tapping in the end of that as well. So that should be fun. It's also got a square on the end of it as well that needs machining on the end. So that would be a nice little challenge as well. So that may very well be the next video, would be another shaft. Although with it, I might alternate between shaft and castings on this project. So let's see how the feel takes me when it comes to doing the next part. Thank you once again, everyone. If you like this video, please make sure to give me a thumbs up. And if you really like this video and you want to see more content from my channel, make sure you click that subscribe button and then turn on notifications by clicking that little bell. That really helps a lot. Thank you very much, everyone. Stay safe, and I will see you next time. Cheerio.